can we start at the very beginning of your story? So you're 22 now?
Yes, 22.
All right. And when did your how old were you when your story began?
My story began when I was 14 years old.
Right.
I was misdiagnosed for 4 years, and I spent 4 years with a lump that I didn't know what it was.
Yeah.
And first of all, I was told it was a fatty lump, and then I was told it was neurofibromatosis. And just on my, after my 18th birthday, I was diagnosed with alveolar soft tissue sarcoma, which is very rare.
So, to start with, it's difficult for a 14-year-old girl anyway to find a lump and to do something about it. So did you immediately do something, or even at that age, did you kind of hold off on doing something?
I've always been very close to my mum and my dad, so I told my mum straight away, and mum was like, I don't really know what that is. She was quite concerned, really. Mm. Took me to the GP straight away, and the GP said, it's nothing to worry about. And I went to see a specialist because I was sent there just because my mum kind of constantly said that she was not unhappy about it, and I had MRI scans, and that was when I had it measured every year because it did grow. And I was told after my 18th birthday, actually, Stacey, you need to go somewhere because something's wrong.
So 4 years passed with this. What happened on the day when you were finally diagnosed?
Well, my mum got the news over the telephone, and I remember her just saying to me, Stacey, sit down. And I said, why? Why have I got to sit down? I don't understand why I have to sit down. She said, just sit down. Well, I refused. Mum told me, Stacey, you've got cancer. So I remember thinking, what do you mean I've got cancer? Old people get cancer, young people don't get cancer.
Yeah.
So I just instantly collapsed on the floor, started crying, was hysterical, and then my mum started telling all my family, as you do.
Right.
And I just remember it was very quick from them, and I was very lucky.
So you were immediately taken into an adult ward?
Yeah,
What hospital was that?
It was the Royal Marsden in Chelsea.
Right.
And I just remember being told, I think it was like a weekday that I was diagnosed, and I just remember being told, if it wasn't Easter, Stacey, you could have the operation the next day.
Right.
I went for my consultation, and the doctor turned around to me and said, I don't know what's going to happen. You might have your leg amputated. And I remember thinking, why?
Yeah.
That really frightened me, and that was the first thing he said. That really, really frightened me.
Yeah. And for the people who are lucky enough to have the support of the Teenage Cancer Trust, which you weren't, you're on a normal adult ward. All the work they do in every hospital in every ward is amazing. But it's just different with the Teenage Cancer Trust because of a certain age and support. What was it like for you with the people around you? Because of course, adult just means from 18 to however old.
Really, it was quite strange because I just remember being really, really poorly, having no one to talk to, and my mum and dad obviously came and visited me. My boyfriend came and visited, my family came and visited, but it wasn't the same because I never had nobody to relate to, because being a teenager and being told that you've got cancer is bad enough, but being in a ward with people that are a lot older than you,
yeah,
and not being able to, like people saying to me, their cancer's recurred, I don't want to hear that. I don't want to hear that their cancer's recurred. I want to hear positive things.
Yeah.
And I found that people that have been treated on teenage wards are really lucky because they have activities going on. And I remember just having a nap in the afternoon and thinking, I'm a bit young to be napping in the afternoon. So I refused.
And so what was that like for you when you found out, you know, other people are lucky enough to get this and that's what you ended up with?
Honestly, I was really, really angry.
Yeah.
And that's probably quite selfish because I had quite good treatment, obviously, but I was really, really angry because I thought it's so unfair because I just turned 18 and I was quite a naive 18-year-old.
Mm.
And I thought, like, I'm probably better off with people that were similar ages to me, kind of can relate to each other, share our stories, and it'd have been better, I think, just to have someone to talk to. I never had that. I didn't have anyone to talk to for probably a year, 2 years, when my mum set me up with Teenage Cancer Trust.
Right. When you came in, we're having a chat, you said life's pretty good now.
Life's better.
Okay.
I don't think anyone's life's perfect.
Yeah.
I do work now, so that's a big thing. I work as an occupational therapist. And I think the only reason I work as an occupational therapist, or case management I work in, was because I had cancer. I think before that, I think my life probably wasn't going anywhere. I probably wouldn't have done what I'm doing right now.
Really?
In terms of, I was just doing my A-levels, and I wasn't really thinking. I just thought, oh, my life would just go happy, but yeah. It didn't. So, yeah, I didn't really think about what I wanted to do. Now I've got a focus. And the biggest thing for me was passing my driving test.
Really?
Because I was told I'd never be able to drive.
And how quickly did you pass your driving test?
Well, I was 18 when I had the cancer, and I passed my driving test when I was 19. And then my mum and dad bought me a car. So I was really happy.
Brilliant. And then you did a degree?
Yeah, I've done my degree, and I just qualified last year. That was really nice.
If someone's 18, they're on an adult ward, what would your advice be to them?
My advice would be to find out about all the services that are actually available to younger people, because there are services out there for younger people. And I think Teenage Cancer Trust have been fantastic. So I just think you always have a link nurse. Your link nurse will tell you information, and they're pointing you in the right direction. And I think it's always worth asking. Don't leave it, because I think if you leave something, it gets worse, and then you have no one to talk to. So that's what I would do.
And for anyone under 18, maybe lucky enough to be supported by the Teenage Cancer Trust, but maybe going through something similar to what you went to, but maybe a few years younger, what would your advice be to them?
I think just be positive about what's going on, and try and take every opportunity to go to Teenage Cancer Trust events, because I think you meet fantastic people along the way, and I think the people that you meet will be lifelong friends, and you obviously share a similar experience. So yeah, just be positive about everything.
Okay, we've spoken to Stacey. Let's talk to Mum Karen.
Okay.
Thanks for coming in.
Thank you.
She did well.
She did.
You're dreading this interview, aren't you?
I am.
we've heard Stacey's story, and for you, those 4 years must have been worrying.
Oh, very worrying.
Those first, from 14 to 18.
Very worrying. I knew there was something wrong, and I do believe you should go with your instinct as a mother or as a parent.
Right.
And the times I've been told I was a neurotic mother. Mm. We actually did pay private to have Stacey tested as well, but they wouldn't test her.
Right.
So it cost us money as well.
Yeah.
But, it was a worrying time, and it did cause trouble between me and my husband, because I kept saying to him, something's wrong, and he said, no, we've had it tested, you know, we're under the doctor. So, no, it was very worrying.
So what was it like for you, mum and dad, visiting on a normal adult ward? Because, of course, a ward full of teenagers, I've never been on one, but I can imagine there's a certain atmosphere, whereas it's on a normal adult ward. What was it like for you visiting?
It was hard. It was a lot of preparation into actually getting to the hospital. We always had to make sure that we had money for the meters for the car. We had to prepare ourselves, so we was there all day, because Stacey would not let us go home. She played up before we had to go home at night. I think the visiting ended at 10 o'clock at night, and she played up then, so I used to have to asked the nurse if we could have a sleeping pill, because she wouldn't, she'd be screaming. Whereas if she was in a younger person's ward, she could have gone with them and sat with them in a room, I presume, instead of being with adults that are already asleep.
And when she was finally out of hospital and back home with you, it must have been great to have her home again.
It was lovely. It was lovely. She had loads of support from her school friends. They came round. It was quite noisy because everybody wanted to see her. Lots of reactions from different friends. Mm. You know, some of them would say sort of questions, you know, have you lost your hair? Silly questions, you know. You know, how do you walk? You know, it was silly questions, but some of them were very nice.
And did you know about the Teenage Cancer Trust before all this happened?
No.
Okay.
No, I found out about it. I got Stacey, because Stacey recuperating was quite depressed. So I decided to phone up the cancer research shops to say, be a volunteer. And then I went on the internet and I found, I put in teenage cancer, I think, and Teenage Cancer Trust came up. And I thought, oh, that looks good. So we went on that. And from then, Stacey took over and she got herself involved.
Brilliant. Yeah. And so since you found out about it, what do you...
It's brilliant.
Have you noticed about the work they do?
It's lovely. It's excellent. We, in the early days, we used to go to lots of visits and that with other teenagers and the mums. And it was good that Stacey would go off. We went ice skating and all things like that. Yeah. And she, or bowling, we've done loads of things. And she would be with the other teenagers and the mums and the dads and all the family would be talking, and it was good. In a way, it was a sad day because it brought it all back, but it was very good that it got it out of our systems, because we could talk to people and they could understand what we're going through, because they're going through it themselves.
Yeah. You know what I've noticed, both of you, since when you walked in and we said hi, and then we sat down and did all this, is you're both cracking jokes and laughing and seeming in a really good place. Is that right?
Yeah. Yeah, it's very good, yeah.
Excellent. Well, look, thank you very much for coming in.
Thank you.
All the best.